Good morning. In Parashat Shoftim, we read by the beginning of the parasha an unexpected commandment about the kind of altars that we must build for sacrifice. You see, you have two kinds of altars. One is what's called the matseva, a standing stone, which is one solid block of stone onto which you would offer a sacrifice. Basically, an altar is a platform for offering sacrifices. And the second way to do it would be to make a composite altar, either through piling up a pile of stones or through creating a frame, let's say a wooden frame, that you fill then with earth or with stones or with something like that. So the Torah tells us in a Perek Etet Zayin Pasuk Chaf Bet, chapter 16, verse 22, V'lo takim lacha matseva asher sanei Adonai Elohecha. You may not set up for yourself a matseva that Hashem your God hates. You may not set up an altar that Hashem your God hates. That standing stone. And there are a couple of questions here. Number one, why can't we do it? There are many things that we can't do. Many times the answer to a mitzvah is because that's what Hashem said, which is fine. But the Torah seems to be inviting us to understand it a little bit more because it tells us Hashem hates this. Well, what is so detestable about a standing stone altar as opposed to a composite altar? Secondly, the problem is that historically we find that not only idol worshippers used such a stone, but in fact, Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov built matzevot, they offered to Hashem, with these standing stones. A third question is that, in fact, we'll wait till we see Rashi, till we see the third question. Rashi comes to explain this, and he says, why does Hashem hate it? Mizbeach avanim u'mizbeach adamatzi v'lasot. An altar of stones or of earth we were commanded to make, as we explained. But this Hashem hates, because this was a religious law for the Canaanites. This was something that the Canaanites did. This was something that symbolized idol worship. So what about the forefathers? Even though it was beloved to Hashem in the days of the forefathers, today he hates it. Since these people have made it into a law for idol worship. What's Rashi saying? He's saying that something is judged, is evaluated, is appropriate for the service of Hashem, not only because of what it is intrinsically. He says intrinsically there's no difference between a matzeva and a mizbeach, but it's what it represents. The mizbeach has now been taken on as a symbol of idol worship, of religious corruption, of the entire way in which the world lost its way religiously. He says something that has become a symbol for that sort of corruption can no longer be used for the service of Hashem. When the forefathers did it, it still hadn't become so entrenched as the way of the idol worshippers serving. Now we can have the third question, which we'll deal with quite briefly. Third question is that we find the Canaanites didn't only use matseva. They also used a mizbeach. They also used the composite altar, not only the standing stone. So why weren't all altars rejected? So the Ramban says on that primarily they used matzevot. It's true they also had mizbachot. It's true they also had the composite altars. Primarily they had the standing stones. Fine. So this is Rashi's approach. Intrinsically, there's no difference. Practically speaking, it has become a symbol of idol worship. In the days of the forefathers, it wasn't. Today it is. You must be very careful what kind of symbols you choose for yourself and for your service of Hashem. The Maharal of Prague takes a different approach in Nativ HaDin, in the Path of Judgment, his book, Path of Justice, where he says, in fact, there is an intrinsic difference between a matzeva and a mizbeach. He says that they change the way, or they indicate a different relationship with Hashem. He says, you see, a matseva is one solid block, and that symbolizes or is an expression of relating to God as one power. But you need to know that God is not one power. God is one God, but that one God has power over everything. That one God, so to speak, contains within him all of the various forces which to us seem so contradictory and different. But within Hashem, they all emanate from that same source. That's something we say in our prayers every single day. Before we say the Shema in the morning, we say, Yotzer Or Uverei Choshech. Hashem creates light and creates darkness. We say in the Amidah, Melech Meimit Umechayeh, the King who brings death and gives life. Hashem is able to encompass the entire spectrum. because he is this oneness that includes everything. However, the idol worshippers did not view Hashem in this way, did not have this realization. They attributed every separate, disparate force to a disparate cause, to a different god. In fact, I remember once looking up on Wikipedia Canaanite gods, and there's a long list of gods for every phenomena imaginable. There's a god of the dawn and a god of the dusk and a god of day and a god of night and a god of the sun and a god of the moon and a god of the sea and a god of the land and a god of agriculture and a god of fertility, you name it. There's gods of everything. And so therefore, when a Canaanite would build an altar, they wouldn't just worship some general god. There wasn't such a thing. They would build an altar to the god of the sea, and they would worship the god of the sea. Hashem hates that. Hashem hates people completely losing the point, making nature into a god without realizing that there is a transcendent force that encompasses everything. That's what Hashem really is. And so therefore, when we build our altars out of stones, what we are doing is we're taking many separate forces and unifying them together in the same way that Hashem is one and yet is able to produce this vast variety of phenomena. That's the Maharal's explanation. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're saying, but what about the forefathers? What about Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov? They most certainly were not idol worshippers, and it's true. The Maharal has an answer to that. He says that our forefathers were the building blocks of the Jewish people. Each of them was a unique individual who came with one particular approach that dominated his service of Hashem. For example, we know Avraham was chesed, Avraham was loving kindness, Yitzchak was din or gevura, judgment or strength, Yaakov is known as rachamim or emet, as compassion or truth. Each of them had a dominant theme in their lives that they brought into the world. And that together with all of those, as Shlomo HaMelech said, as King Solomon said, Chut HaMeshulash Lo B'Mehera Yinatek, the threefold thread will not be cut very easily. They brought these three forces together, and with those created a nation. So he says each of the Avot really was a Matzeva, really came to connect to a particular aspect of God, not denying the other elements of God, but that was what they brought into the world. However, today he says now that there's an entire Jewish nation, now that we are no longer individuals primarily, but members of the Jewish people, our service of Hashem must reflect this. And it is, our altars are composed of stones of earth that is brought together rather than the one standing stone. A final explanation that I'd like to share with you is from Rabbi Moshe Feinstein. And he says that, again, there's an intrinsic difference between the Mizbeach and the Matzeva, that the Matzeva, the standing stone, represents a sort of finality of accomplishment, a sort of an ability to say, well, this is what's been done, and it stands, and it stays. And he says, for example, somebody who spends his entire life doing good things, and then at the end of his life, completely changes direction and discards it, the Matzeva is still there. The pillar, the standing stone, still exists. So he says, that's not the truth. That's not the truth. That's not the Jewish way. The Jewish approach is that your life is constantly reinterpreted. That whoever you are right now sheds a different light on your entire life up until now. That a person who is wicked his entire life but then does teshuva, every action he's ever done becomes cast in a different way. And that's, I think, a beautiful and appropriate thought as you go into the month of Elul. That who you are now changes the context of all of your previous actions. It's not a matzeva, it's not a standing stone which sits there. It's an altar. Our lives are an altar, or a mizbeach, where something is added, where something is taken away, where it's a constant work in progress. Not just the present is being processed, but the past also. And that is our responsibility and our power to make sure that what we do sheds a good light, not only on who we are now, but on who we have been our entire lives. Have a wonderful Shabbos.